Hello, welcome along to the Yorkshire Football Show. It's that time of year again to have a look back at everything happening in the world of Yorkshire football. And I'm joined, as always, by the man who really likes to rile the Huddersfield Town fans, Joe Rawson. Joe, how are you doing?
I'm very well. I don't like to rile them. I just give my honest opinion.
You do it once a week, though, to be fair. So I will give you that. I will give you that. And Liam Williams, a friend of Barnsley fans. How are you doing, Liam?
Yeah, good, man. Good.
Yeah, good stuff. Good stuff. let's start off with Leeds United. We've got to start off with them. Big win for them against Birmingham this weekend. 3-1 win, job done.
Yeah, it really was just a job done. I don't think they were the better team. I think Birmingham had more of the play. But they're just clinical at the minute. And when you've got a player like Chris Wood in your side, you've always got a chance. And they created, what, three opportunities for him, and he scored two of them. So, you know, it's not a bad strike rate. 23 goals, is it now, this season for him? And he's just going strength to strength. Good that Pedraza is off the market as well. I think that'll be a big boost because he could be a key player as they move towards the playoffs, or indeed a push to automatic promotion, which you can't rule out yet. Because
do you think that can be done?
Look, I don't want to say it can't, because Brighton keep slipping up and Leeds continue to win games, even though I don't think they're playing particularly well. So if they do hit some form, and they've all got to play each other still.
You said that Huddersfield Town were too far away, but Leeds United, though they're further behind, have got a chance.
No, I said they were too far away about 3 months ago.
Just last week you were saying, I don't think they'll make it.
No, I don't think Huddersfield will get into the top two. I don't think Leeds will get into the top two. But you can't rule it out mathematically. I mean, Huddersfield, which we'll get onto, did have a real opportunity to close the gap just to 3 points with the game in hand. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you can't say that they're not going to make it, because mathematically they can. But I think, in my personal opinion, it will be playoffs for both of those sides. That win on Friday has more or less secured Leeds their playoff place. They go to Fulham this week, which is obviously huge because they're the side immediately outside of the top six. If they can pick up anything from that game, as long as they don't lose, I think that's playoff place secure, job done for Gary Monk. And then you can look at up the table, because you don't have to worry and look over your shoulder, do you?
What do you make of it with Leeds United then, Liam? Is that playoff pot now secured? Should be the looking upwards now towards the automatics? Or what do you make of it?
I don't know. I think Fulham's a tough game for them, because I think Fulham have to win this game now. With them still being just sort of on the brink of the playoffs, and they've got some tough away fixtures for them. I think they've got Newcastle, Derby, Huddersfield and maybe Sheffield Wednesday. So they've really got to take advantage of the home ones. A draw, I think, would be a good result for Leeds midweek.
I look at Fulham, are they the only playoff contender now that can sort of knock the Yorkshire teams off their perch?
Yeah, I just think Norwich could have done, Derby could have done, but they've just dropped too many points in recent weeks. And I think at this stage of the season, you're talking 10 games left or so. You know, you're really asking these teams to win nearly every single game, and then the likes of Leeds to drop points. So for me, the playoffs are now a five-horse race for four places.
The problem is, if there is going to be one team that can do it, like you say, with Fulham, it's just sheer inconsistency. One week, they'll be absolutely brilliant. The Barcelona, the Championship, the next week, not so good.
Well, that's it. Fulham are a side that are very good going forward, but concede a lot of goals as well. So tomorrow night, I expect Leeds maybe to exploit Fulham at the back with the likes of Chris Wood in such good form. I think they have the pace with either Barrow or Sacco playing down the sides. Look, we know they're dangerous going forward, but Leeds have been great defensively, haven't they, this season? Rob Green just has got better and better, and he had another good game on Friday. So, you know, it's a tough game, but I fancy Leeds to pick something up at Craven Cottage. Though, having said that, Fulham were one of the best sides I've seen this season. When they came to Elland Road, they played Leeds off the park, but Leeds got a draw. Chris Wood getting a late goal in that game to salvage a 1-1 draw. So, yeah, if they pick up a draw, then I think that's job done for them. You know, it's the case of just not lose for Leeds tomorrow night.
Yeah, very much seems that way. Let's hear from Gary Monk speaking to Radio Yorkshire.
What did that look like from the stands?
I didn't enjoy the first 60 minutes, if I'm honest. We were second best, especially the first half. And then we spoke at half time. We needed to trust ourselves a little bit more. I felt it looked like we felt a bit restricted, you know, in terms of our, you know, our mentality or whether they felt pressure to win the game and all of this. But I said to them before the start, you know, we're playing against a very good side. I know they are where they are in the league and they've had a difficult run of games in terms of results, but that's a group of players that have been pushing for the playoffs for the last 2 years. So I reminded the players of that before the game, and you saw tonight, I thought they were excellent, but Birmingham, especially in that first 60 minutes, and it was tough for us. But again, our mentality is so strong, you can see it. Very clear mentality and spirit to fight and defend in those pressures, and we probably suffered too much pressure, which we were disappointed with. But I think then from that last half an hour, we were excellent. I thought that was the real us, and that's what we've been doing and how we've been trying to play. And we looked very dangerous. We created chances, scored some really good goals, and very clinical. And in the end, won the game comfortably. But it wasn't through a lack of performance from Birmingham.
Gary Monk there speaking to Radio Yorkshire, and to be fair, Joe, it seems like one of the biggest things that Leeds United need to do is actually sign up Gary Monk to a long-term contract.
Yeah, it was interesting in the press conference last Wednesday. I asked him about his future because he continues to get linked with other jobs because he's not on a long-term contract. So Rangers at the minute, his name keeps popping up. With that job, and it's because the compensation fee isn't a lot of money when you're only paying off a couple of months of the contract. I know that Gary has recently moved his family up to Yorkshire though, so that to me is a big indication that he is going to sign a new deal. I just think the supporters would prefer to see it done sooner rather than later, and just to keep the stability at Elland Road, which there hasn't been for years. And he will be a man in demand. I think him saying about his future not being done yet in that press conference was almost a nod to, look, come and sign me up, make me an offer, because he is a man in demand from other football clubs at the minute because he's doing such a great job. You know, it's like form players. Form players attract attention. Form managers are exactly the same.
Yeah, no doubt about that. Let's look back to that Birmingham game. Let's hear from the Birmingham manager Zola after that defeat that leaves them now in 17th place.
You know, the results certainly doesn't reflect what happened on the pitch. But in the end of the day, it's what has made the difference was the fact that on the other side there was a player that he touched three balls and he scored two, and he made a big difference. Maybe we made a couple of mistakes. One was due to inexperience. One probably we could avoid it, but. To be honest, it's very difficult for me to say anything to the team because when they put a performance like that against the third team in the league, it's you have nothing to say. Just encourage them and tell them do it again on Tuesday because the result is going to be different.
Birmingham manager there speaking to Radio Yorkshire after that game, and I suppose it says a lot about managers in demand. Gary Rowett obviously being linked with just about here, there and everywhere, but it shows you Birmingham slide after getting rid of him. 17th place now, I wouldn't have expected that, Lynn.
Well, I think you would when Gary Rowett goes, because especially, I mean, the funny thing is, they seemed to get Zola so quickly. It was like Zola had been lined up a few days before, maybe even weeks before they got rid of Rowett, which was just baffling considering how well they were doing. I think they were seventh in the table when he went. Performing fantastically. The football might not have been the most attractive. It was more about being organised and hitting sides on the counter, but it was effective, and they sort of threw all that in for whatever reason, and it's backfired badly.
Yeah, absolutely bonkers there, and I suppose that's a blueprint for all owners of football clubs on how not to run a football club when you originally take over. Anyway, let's look at a well-run football club in Huddersfield Town. Obviously going from strength to strength, but just didn't seem to have everything that they needed against Newcastle, to be honest. Got defeated by them at the John Smith Stadium. And what do you make of the gap now between them and the top two?
If Brighton carry on as they were for most of the season, the top two for me is already decided. It's just if Brighton continue these little slips. If they start to feel a bit twitchy, you know, come the running, that will then open it up for the other sides. But the way I've seen it all season, Brighton and Newcastle a level above everyone else. So for me, it was everyone else basically competing for a playoff place. You look, Brighton losing 3-0 to Nottingham Forest. That's two losses on the bounce, and you maybe are there doubts in their mind all of a sudden. For me, it's now. It's not so much that Huddersfield can catch them as more as Brighton can fall into the the playoffs just by, you know, losing the games that they are doing. As long as the likes of Huddersfield and Leeds carry on as they are, maybe they could do, but it wouldn't be a case of them getting into the top two as Brighton falling out of it.
Yeah, and it's interesting you say that as well, because obviously we know everything that happened last year with Brighton as well, so that's always sticking in the back of their mind. Joe, when you look at Huddersfield and how they played against Newcastle, obviously at one point it looked like they might be able to turn it around, but 3-1 defeat, it was fairly convincing from Newcastle as well, but I suppose it just shows you that Newcastle really are a Premier League team.
Well, Newcastle have had a great couple of games, haven't they? They beat rivals, and they say come Reading tomorrow night, if they can get three away wins in a row, then I think that's job done for Rafa, and I think that's pretty much promotion secure. As far as Huddersfield are concerned, I thought they were a little bit disappointing against Newcastle. Danny Ward had a bit of a dodgy game, which, you know, he's been a really good acquisition. He's been a really good goalkeeper throughout the season, but he had an off day against Newcastle. I think it was a penalty, but then Huddersfield got one themselves, yeah, and Aaron Moy dispatched it. I don't think it's anything to worry about for Huddersfield Town fans, but it is a real opportunity that they missed once again. And I mentioned this last week when they were playing Barnsley, they dominated the game, and if you think they could have picked up two extra points from that one, then at home, I know you're taking on Newcastle, but they could have essentially been in the top two with a game in hand. So they missed opportunities, and I know I got a bit of stick from Newcastle from Huddersfield Town fans for saying that, but I just think they have missed the boat a little bit. If they are to play catch-up, which they are doing, they have had opportunities and they missed them. Now, I'm not saying Huddersfield aren't going to finish in the top six. I'm not saying playing against Newcastle it is an easy game, because they are the best team in the division. But if you're playing catch-up and you're trying to you know, rein in the teams above you, you need to win those sort of games, particularly the Barnsley one, the games that you dominate, which they didn't. You know, I have changed my mind on Huddersfield from a few months ago. Again, I know we played the clip last week, but I thought at the start of the season, and even coming up towards Christmas, I looked at the squad and I honestly felt a lot of unknowns from Bundesliga 2 and a lot of players coming in on loan from Premier League clubs who, again, unknown in the Championship. Thought, probably mid-table, maybe top half at this squad. Now, they have proved me wrong, and they are doing exceptionally well, and now they have a real opportunity, but, you know, you need to grasp these opportunities, because for a club like Huddersfield, they don't come round too often. And I just feel in the past couple of games, they've let themselves down a little bit compared to the Huddersfield Town that I've seen. You know, they went on a run six wins in a row. So just the last two performances have let them down a little bit. Take nothing away from the season they're having, and they will be in the playoffs, no problem. But it really looked like they could get into the automatic spots, and I just feel they've dipped a little bit over the last couple of weeks.
What do you make of it then with Huddersfield, Liam? Like I say, a little bit of a blip, an off day against Newcastle, hoping to put it right against Aston Villa, but I suppose it is a tough run of fixtures.
Yeah, I think you could forgive the blip when they went on that run that they did of winning games. Like I said to you, I think the only way that they make the top two is if Brighton fall out of it. Other than that, consolidate where you are and sort of focus on peaking at the right time. Now, if they can go on a good run these last few games, like the final 3, 4, 5 games of the season, go into the playoffs on a high, that would be big. Because if they were playing, say, Reading, who for example have beaten not so long ago, Leeds, who I think they've done the double over this season, they've got a good record over these sides this season, so mentally it might be a nice little factor for them if they were to play these sides. But if they can go into the playoffs in a good run of form, I think that will help, and they could them and Sheffield Wednesday probably be the favourites to go up between them.
I was going to say, it does look like they're probably one of the strongest contenders for me in the playoffs for Huddersfield Town.
Yeah, I mean, what, they need probably 3 more wins to guarantee their playoff spot, which is why they're 1-33 on to be in the top 6, and it's already guaranteed. So now David Wagner can manage the squad to try and peak at the right time. And the thing is, they're not out of the race for the top 2 just yet. And we've mentioned Brighton, and I agree with Liam, it is down to whether they fall out of the top two, but they did it last season, so it could happen again. and Huddersfield will want to make sure they're the team to try and take advantage of that, and they can only be that team by winning games.
What I will say is I think this season might be slightly different in the sense that last season you had Middlesbrough, Burnley and Brighton, who for me was not much of a muchness. I don't think there's that third team this year. I don't think Huddersfield, Leeds, whoever else you want to put, is the same quality that there was last season. I think this one is more of a two-horse race than it was last year.
Let us know. Get in touch in the comments and remember to like and subscribe to Radio Yorkshire Today as well. Let's hear from the man himself, David Fagner. He was speaking to the press after that game.
We played well. I think the players tried and rested everything. I was very happy with their working attitude and that they always kept the head up, and this wasn't easy because it was harsh to take the first two goals which we conceded. I still believe that the first pen isn't a pen. Maybe there's handball before the situation as well, and the second goal, if Danny Ward controls the ball, then he's not allowed to get attacked, and he got attacked. Unfortunately, he as well got knocked in this situation, and this was the reason why he was not able to carry on. And as I said before, in this game's details will be the situations which decided the game, and unfortunately and obviously these details went against us today. What we did in the second half, that we really tried everything against a top team, everybody knows this, and I think Newcastle has shown this today as well. They are very difficult to break down when they are so compact and stable and defend in the deep block. But even in this situation, we tried everything. We scored the 2-1 and had some half chances to maybe make the equalizer. But again, I think at the end, a good performance from my side. I have no complaints, but we lost this football match. And this is what we have to accept.
David Viner there, Huddersfield Town head coach, speaking to the press after that game. Let's hear what Rafa Benitez had to say about the Terriers.
What have you made of Huddersfield, not just tonight, this season?
No, it's a good team. I said before that they are in a position that they deserve because they are playing well. They have confidence. They didn't have any pressure before, so they could play, they could enjoy their football. And now every game, every point that maybe you will lose will mean something for them. But at the moment, you can see that they try with their style to control the games, and they have a very good result during the whole season. Really, really pleased for them in the way that they are doing, and we will see what happens. But I think I told the manager, I was talking with him now, that they are doing really well, and I think they will be very, very close.
That was Rafa Benitez there speaking about Huddersfield Town. And to be fair, it's a very different Huddersfield Town than the one that we would have seen in previous years. And especially for the likes of Newcastle there as well. I suppose it shows you how far Huddersfield Town have come now then.
Yeah, I think it's a combination of the manager, David Wagner, changing the style of play and his recruitment in the players that they've brought in. Like Joe mentioned, there were quite a few unknown quantities coming over. Colin Quarno's another one now. Mm. He had Izzy Brown dropping down, Casey Palmer. Few players who we've not seen much of, but they have sort of hit the ground running there. And I think in terms of a first 11, they are as strong as any team outside of the top two. It's the replacements that are coming in. I think they've got maybe three like-for-like replacements in the squad at most. And beyond that, I think if they are to get a couple of injuries in the running, it could hit them.
We'll wait and see. But like there's two quality players for every position there. So I think there would have to be unlucky.
I'm not sure there are, though.
Yeah, I agree with Liam. I think there are two players for every position. But whether they're similar quality or not.
But this is the same.
I think all across the back line.
This is the same team that held Manchester City to a 0-0 draw in the FA Cup.
No, I'm not having that as a one-off game. And it was a one-off game.
It was a one-off
same
game.
Team, the same team then lost 5-1. And they gave a decent account of themselves, but they're not the same. They're not the same level.
I mean, let's face it. They were playing like Sterling and Aguero and De Bruyne. I mean, it's a different kettle of fish.
Yeah, but that's it. City also, I think, even the players that were playing in that first game had their minds on the Champions League match in midweek. So, you know, it's a one-off FA Cup game. We saw Sutton knock out, you know, Leeds.
Yeah, I'm not getting into that. What I'm saying is that the second team there together managed to do that. But if you're replacing one or two players, I don't see what the problem is.
No, I think they've got, you know, a couple who are like for like in quality terms. But I do think, you know, you look at, is it Dwayne Holmes, fullback? I don't think he's particularly brilliant, still a young player.
Yeah, Tariq Holmes, isn't
he? Yeah, that's it. Tariq Holmes, who, you know, in that FA Cup game, he got tore a new, you know.
Yeah, but if you're replacing one player for another, it's very different.
I think the entire back line, if you took one player out, you wouldn't be able to get anyone who's even nearly as good as Smith, Lerva, Heffler or Schindler. Midfield, you can get Billing in. Then that sort of three-quarter line, I think you've got four players in Brown, Palmer, Kachunga and Van der Parry. So pick any three of the four, and then your front line, you've got Wells or Kwana, who I think would do a decent job. But defensively for me, if they suffer injuries on that, in that back line, that's when trouble will start.
I don't know. I think you've got the likes of White there. I think you've got Stankovic as well. Don't get me wrong, he hasn't played the entire time.
Yeah, I've not been that impressed by Stankovic when I've seen him play this season. And I know he's not played enough.
No, he hasn't played too much.
But when I've seen him come in, I've not been greatly impressed by him, I'll be honest. I mean, I'd rather see Hudson playing in there than Stankovic.
Well, we'll wait and see anyway. Huddersfield Town fans, let us know what you think as well. Let's move on. We've got time restraints and all the rest of it as well. Let's have a look at Sheffield Wednesday. And I was saying, you know, they haven't been hitting fifth gear for quite a few games now, and it didn't seem like they were getting the wins that they rightly wanted, but absolutely trouncing Norwich, to be fair. And I'll put a few smiles back on a few doom and gloomers over Ellsborough.
Huge game this was, as well, in terms of Norwich just being outside the playoff positions. But Wednesday took Norwich apart, in all fairness. Jordan Rose on the score sheet a couple of times, Forestieri on the score sheet as well, Ross Wallace with the opener after a dreadful error by John Ruddy. But what a finish. I mean, he nearly put it in from the halfway line, and this is what Sheffield Wednesday fans have been waiting for since the signings in January, for them to really beat a team and beat one of the sides who are round and about them. And again, it just puts that cushion between themselves and the rest back in place. Fulham is the side to watch out for, and Leeds could do Wednesday a massive favour, as well as Reading and Huddersfield, by beating Fulham tomorrow night. But a good performance, and the best we've seen from Sheffield Wednesday for a while.
Is it finally starting to click now with the amount of attackers they've got over there at Wednesday?
I'm not sure it's necessarily finally starting to click, but I think you've seen now in that one game what they have got, the potential they've got, and like Joe says, what we've been waiting to see since the January transfer window. You know, Norwich aren't a bad side at all, they've put five past them. But they've got a series of fixtures now where you think it's probably time to consolidate and time to kick on a little bit, because Leeds, like I mentioned, playing Fulham, sides are going to drop points there. Time for them to kick on, and I think especially beating Norwich, it has now made it. I still think Norwich could have made the playoffs, as could have Derby as of a few weeks ago, but that game for me sort of sealed that, and it's now between five sides.
It very much looks that way. Let's have a look elsewhere at a couple of playoff dark horse contenders at one point as well. Got to look over to Derby against Barnsley, and to be fair, some people say this is a must win game for Derby because that's be able to get them in there. I just think they've got too much ground to make up. I think it's gone. Barnsley very much seems like that sort of have gone as well. Liam, you took some flack earlier on in the season.
Yeah, a little bit.
Just a little bit. A little bit on Twitter. Yeah. That's popular as Thatcher down in Barnsley at that point. But yeah, they lost that game, but it just does seem farther away.
All I said after the beat Leeds was that they conceded too many shots to be able to keep outscoring teams. There's only Rotherham who have conceded more shots this season than Barnsley. That is it. You can't keep doing that and keep winning games unless you are going, you've got some serious firepower, and they lost Hourihan and Winnell. So that set them back. Since that Leeds game, I think they've got 9 points from 8 games. I said at the time they will finish at least 12 points away from the playoffs. They're currently 11 points outside, and there's another 10 games to go. I think they've scored 7 goals in those 8 games. The goals have now just dried up. I said all this would happen, and it has. It doesn't surprise me.
Mystic Meg Williams over here.
But
looking at Barnsley, I mean, I've said it a few times that you look at the start of the season, they'd be happy to be up and around there. Do you think they've got the building blocks in place at the release for Paul Hickenbottom to build something in the summer?
Well, it all depends who signs new contracts at the club. That's the big problem. And, you know, they have got a few who are going to be there, and they brought in Alex Mowat during the January transfer window. Good player who, I think, with a full pre-season and more game time under his belt, could flourish. Mm. They'll be hoping to keep Matty James, who they've got on loan from Leicester, if they can do some sort of deal for him. And if Leicester stay in the Premier League, then I don't see why not. I can't see him playing too much in the Premier League. So even if they want to keep him, Leicester, it could be a season-long loan deal to Barnsley. And look, they were in front against Derby and then they fell away. And judging by what Paul Heckingbottom has said after the game, plenty of effort from his players. Said he couldn't have a go at the commitment, but they just lack that quality, which is the problem now, because they've had Winnall, Horahan and Bree taken out. It's almost a spine that they've lost there. Mm. And particularly Horahan, for me, he was where the quality came from. For Barnsley throughout the start of the season. They brought in Matty James to replace him. Really good player, but he's still getting up to full match fitness, because he just hasn't played an awful lot this season. Same with Mowen.
That's very true, and certainly interesting to see how Barnsley get on for the rest of the season, but probably looking towards next season now. I can't imagine pulling up any more
trades. They'd have taken survival, wouldn't they? You know, most
it
fans.
Has been an excellent season. You know, don't take anything away from it. But when they were talking of the playoffs, I just thought it's unrealistic and it won't happen. But finishing mid-table would be an excellent finish for them.
Maybe if they kept the players, it might have been a little bit more.
Not
too many contenders in there for me. For pushing in there, I thought they could have finished further.
You cannot play how they do and keep that up.
I don't know, because they did keep winning. I mean, they were in a good position.
What I will say is they've been the most entertaining side of all the Yorkshire sides to watch, because no matter whether they win, lose or draw, there's always goals. It's very rare you see a Barnsley 0-0.
That's very true. Let's move on to one of their South Yorkshire rivals. Has anyone got anything new to say about Rotherham?
I think they are going down.
Yeah,
I think it might be. I think that loss of the weekend might just be what seals it.
I say that every week, though. I say, "Oh, Rotherham lost again. That's going to be the one that does them."
It's a real shame, because I've got a lot of time for Paul. The players aren't there. The team isn't there to stay in the Championship. It's not been there all season.
But the last 3 weeks, they had games that they could have identified as possible three pointers. They threw away what looked like a draw at Brentford. They were taking on Aston Villa, who had in horrendous form going into the game at home. You know, big club coming to the New York Stadium. You might fancy your chances. You know, the players might have raised the game a little bit because they're playing Aston Villa.
Yeah,
but it's just not happened. And you know what can you say? The sooner this season ends, the better for Rotherham United and Rotherham United fans. I just feel they need to get a new manager in place. And I said this on the radio version of the Yorkshire Football Show last week. Why don't they make an appointment now and say, look, even if that man doesn't want a relegation on his CV, this is the man taking over at the end of the season? Because it's clear Paul Warden doesn't want the job. Mm. And then at least the new man can start planning for life in League One, because otherwise they're going to be playing catch-up.
Yeah, no, that's true, to be fair. But, I don't have anything new to say. I mean, it can't be long now before they're mathematically relegated, can it?
They'll be the first ones.
Yeah, no, by far. Let's have a look up at the Premier League. Then let's look over to Hull City. They took on Leicester the weekend. A 3-1 loss for them. Joe's got a smile on his face because I said there might just be a chance that Hull can nick it against Leicester, but obviously this is before we found out that Leicester were going to be new and improved after Ranieri, and it was going to be a big season under Craig Shakespeare. And they're all going to turn into great players again, aren't they?
Well, we knew that Ranieri had gone, and you were pretty scathing on Leicester City, and you felt that Hull City could still get out of the relegation places. And again, it wasn't a particularly bad performance from Hull City. They just lack a little bit of quality. And Leicester, in the last two games, have been the Leicester City of last season. Mahrez and Vardy seemingly back to their best. Old Brighton playing well. And, they turned up at the King Power, and despite falling a goal behind, they kept going like the Leicester of last season and were deserved winners. Take nothing away from Hull. I think the appointments of Marco Silva and the players he's brought in January have improved the side. But it's too little, too late for me. I think, they needed to make that change possibly a little bit earlier. And I've thought Mike Phelan was doing a decent job. Ultimately, they needed to put more investment into the side before the start of the season. The investment that came in January, despite losing Snodgrass, they brought in some decent Premier League players. Mm. That needed to happen at the start of the season, and maybe add a couple more in January. So it's all been a little bit too little too late, because they've been playing catch up by the mess the owners actually left them in at the start of the season. Because when you come up through the playoffs, you're already behind the rest of the sides.
Yeah.
And you know, Hull made it even worse for themselves with the farce over who's going to be in charge. You know, they took so long to decide whether Phelan was going to sign a new contract or not. And I can't see them getting out now. I think them and Sunderland are doomed.
Maybe it's too little too late, Liam?
I'm not sure. I mean, we've seen bigger miracles in the Premier League side staying up than Hull.
Leicester, of course.
Leicester won, but the problem for me now is Sunderland are starting to look doomed, but still could turn around because it's Sunderland. They might end up turning it around. Palace should be fine now. Swansea should be fine now. Middlesbrough might still be in there. They need to turn it around. Leicester, they'll be fine now. So you're basically running out of teams. Watford, Bournemouth.
I'm going to say Bournemouth.
You're running out of teams. You go back a couple of months, eight teams could have gone down, and it wouldn't have been a surprise if any three of the eight would have gone. Now it's sort of that gap's narrowed to about four or five teams, so it is harder for them. But there are signs of quality there. You know, they've shown that they can get results against good sides as well. So you wouldn't. I wouldn't say that they are down. But they are running out of teams who can go down. That's their problem.
That's exactly the issue for me. It's who do you replace Hull with in the bottom three at the minute? I don't see anyone else apart from the three that are in it. You know, Middlesbrough have been falling like stone. They don't score many goals. The solidity that they have has suddenly gone to pot. And the other side, Swansea, have turned it around. You'd say that they are safe now. Leicester, there's too much quality in that side. The only one is Crystal Palace, but with Sam Allardyce in charge, he just doesn't go down as a manager, and I can't see it being a first this time. Whereas Karanka is having an almighty battle with the fans at the minute.
Oh, he loves that, doesn't he? He loves stirring the pot, does Karanka.
Exactly, and he's all very unhappy at Middlesbrough. Unless they make a managerial change, which I can't see happening, I think they will go. Hull, too little too late, and Sunderland are just poor.
Yeah, no, I'll give you that. Yeah. I think Sunderland are still. But like we say, there's a lot of football still to be played, and like Liam says, we have seen miracles of bigger kinds happen in the past as well. Let's drop down from the glamour of the Premier League down to League One and pick up on Bradford City first. There's been a lot of talk, Liam, throughout the season that Bradford City play lovely football but just can't get the win. This time, particularly poor game, but managed to get the win. I don't think you can mourn about that so much. It's 3 points at this stage of the season, not too far away from the automatics. I know there's a lot of games in hand and there's a lot of catching up for other teams to do, but they're not in a bad place.
No, looking at the league table, the five points inside the playoffs, but they may have played a game more, and the 5 points outside the top two, I'm pretty sure they have played a game more there. Bolton might have two games in hand, so it's hard to get a proper reflection of where they are at the moment, but it feels like they haven't won consecutive games all season, Bradford, yet they're still in the mix. They should be in the playoffs, and 10 games to go, might still scrape into the automatics. The thing for me is that defensively they've been absolutely excellent all season. Teams struggle to score against them because they're so good with the ball, so struggle to create chances. They seem to maybe have been a little bit more open these last few weeks, since January transfer window, really.
Yeah.
So they're now scoring a few more goals and they're unable to see games out. Now, I've said all season long that Bradford are arguably the unluckiest team in the Football League. They should be much higher with far more points than they are based on how they play, the chances that they make. And people say, oh, you can't be unlucky for 23 games, you can't be unlucky for so long. But that game against Milton Keynes in midweek last week was just unbelievable. The first goal was 25 yards out, speculative effort, goal was deflected in, keeper had no chance. The second goal was a cross, which just looped, it was a cross that looped in off of both posts. It's like this, it sort of sums up Bradford's season. Now, Stuart McCall afterwards said, you know, it's a good point. He said we were looking at 4 points from two games, we did that, now we need a win on Saturday to make it 4 points from these two games, which they did. If Bradford can keep doing that, 4 points from two games throughout the end of the season, beyond 20 more points, might do it. The next few fixtures are crucial. They've got rid of some tough games. They've still got Sheffield United to play.
And Scunthorpe away as
Scunthorpe
well.
And Oxford. I think maybe Rochdale. There's some tough teams to play yet. But these next three include Swindon, Coventry, and it might be Charlton.
Yeah.
Stuart McCall's been saying that they were looking for two from four over these last couple of weeks. I think it's going to have to be seven from three now.
Do you think there's some... I know that Coventry like to change the manager. I think the average tenure this season has been about 12 games.
Yeah.
Obviously, the sack Russell Slade brought in Mark Robbins. Is that unlucky for that to happen to Bradford again, that there might be that sort of new manager? Or does new manager bounce not happen when you've had just this many managers?
We'll see, because I'm not sure that Coventry... saw the home game, actually, when Coventry went to Bradford, and they weren't that bad a side. They ended up losing because Bradford really turned it on in the second half, but they weren't a bad side. Now they're bottom, and you think, well, how's this happened? There's a lot of unrest off the field, and all that won't help. We'll only really see, you know, on how the game goes as to whether or not it's had much of an impact. So it's too soon to tell, you know, whether it's going to actually affect Bradford. But the way they play the football, the ability in the team, the ability from the touchline with Stuart McCall at home to, are they at home to Coventry? If they are at home to bottom of the league, just forget the manager. You've got, are they away?
Yeah.
Either way, you're against bottom of the league. You have to win this one.
Yeah, I was just ticking. I was in a world of my own then, Liam. What have you made of it anyway, Joe?
Well, look, it's a good win at the weekend, a scrappy win, but that's probably what Bradford City haven't had enough of throughout this season. They do play really good football. They're probably the best footballing side I've seen in League One, but they're just not clinical enough. Well, they haven't been. Obviously, that's improved since the January acquisitions of Alex Jones and Charlie Wyke.
Yeah, he was kept scoring despite some of the doubters saying that it wouldn't be.
Oh, all man's up there.
Yeah, so, and you know, Jones has scored a couple of important goals as well.
Actually,
So they're going to be in the playoffs, but they'll look back if they don't get promoted through the playoffs. Bradford City as a club and the fans will look back and think, what could have been? Because they've been in so many games that they should have not drawn, they should have won, or even defeats that they probably should have got something out of, and there's still a way to go. I can't see them closing the gap on the top two. I think Fleet would have surprised everyone, and they are on a roll at the minute. I know Scunthorpe are starting to drop a little bit, but still there's a bit of a gap between Bradford and Scunthorpe. Sheffield United are gone, aren't they? So it's looking like the playoffs, and we'll see what happens. They just need to guarantee they get into the playoffs, because it would be absolutely criminal if they missed out, because they've been too good this season. Like Liam said, they do have a tough fixture list coming up, playing teams around them who will be looking to take points off them and try and claw back that gap. And I don't think there are any easier games when you're playing teams around the bottom, because they're scrapping for their lives. The league is that close at the moment. Even the teams in mid-table have something to play for, because the gap. Think Warsaw, a dead middle of the table, and you know.
Not too long ago, they were relegation candidates.
Yeah,
as well.
But they are. They take on Chesterfield tomorrow, so I've been having a look at the stats because I'm at that game, and Warsaw, I think, are only like 7 points off the playoffs now, which, you know, is a gap. But with 10 games to go, they'll be thinking, there's a possibility. They're probably about 8 points, 9 points away from the bottom four as well. So even the team mid-table are still either aiming high or have got something to play for, looking over the shoulder, which means there are no easy games in the division, because everyone still needs to pick up points. No one's guaranteed their place at the moment, apart from possibly Sheffield United at the top.
Yeah, no, I think you're right there. Let's hear from Stuart McCall, the Bradford City manager, after the game this weekend.
Listen, I think the goal was a bit like the first half. It was just a bit scrappy, wasn't it? But I looked at their formation today, and obviously I watched them play the other night in Millwall, where they played the three midfields, and I think they've gone, you know, the conditions might be 2-4-4-2, and they've got good forwards, you know, and you know, Taylor and Madison are good on wide. So for us to get a clean sheet today was terrific defending, not only by the defenders, by the whole team.
You needed one as well, didn't you?
Yeah.
It's been a while, isn't it?
Yeah, certainly sure. But it was a little bit of a throwback, we said today, to probably my day then, when you didn't have all these formations. It used to always be 4-4-2 against 4-4-2, and that's what it's today, and you had to win your own battles. And I think, you know, we won majority of them. I certainly think second half performance, we merited the result. But it was hard fought. As I said before, there's plenty of ways to win games. You can be lucky, you can be dominant, you can just, you know, be gritty. And I thought that's what we were today. Once we got our nose ahead, I thought some great desire, some really strong performance. I thought the midfield too was superb, but that's not taken away from the defensive lads at the back as well. And it was a team effort, and we needed it today, because, you know, as I said, people were really unfortunate to lose at Millwall the other night to a soft penalty. They probably should have won it, so I knew it was going to be another tough game today. But we got what we wanted.
Stuart McCall speaking to the press after the game. Let's move our attentions over to Sheffield United. Liam, they do look home and host, to be fair, but they've had a couple of draws like this. I mean, it seemed an entertaining one with Rochdale, and I imagine if you might have been like me and had Sheffield United on your accumulator, it might have gone a very different way. But like you said, there's a gap between them. It seems almost a quality between them and the most of the rest of the league, to be fair.
There is, and that's why they'll be fine. You know, they have dropped points recently, but so has everyone else. So no one else has really like been able to, you know, properly punish them for it. And at the end of the day, they're the best team in the league by a fair distance as well. So, you know, they can afford these blips because they will go on another run before the end of the season. Can't guarantee they'll win the league, but they are going up automatically without a doubt for me.
Yeah, no doubt about that. The goal-scoring form that showed as well has been very impressive, to say the least.
Yeah, Billy Sharp with another at the weekend. And yeah, Rochdale has been a tough place to go to for a lot of teams this season. They were in the playoff places only 3 weeks ago, and they've dropped out a little bit. But they're still looking up towards the playoff. As I mentioned, despite being in 11th, they're not too far away. So, you know, these are tough games, and any away point is a good point, particularly when you sat pretty at the top of the table and, you know, your nearest rivals, Scunthorpe, lost, didn't they? Fleetwood beat them, so replaced them. So I don't think the gap has altered for Sheffield United. In fact, it might have increased by a point having won that, having taken a draw from that game. So no worries for Chris Wilder. The squad, it has got so much quality in it, and I think in January he added to that with the likes of Carruthers coming in, Hansen, who's been a steady player, even though he's not scored too many, he's been creating, Jay O'Shea as well. They're there, finally, after all these years. Sheffield United are going to be back in the Championship.
You took your time, Blades, but you're finally doing it. You finally turned the corner. Let's have a look elsewhere. Let's have a look over at Doncaster. Joe, like I've been saying for a while, they are home and host, but ever since I said that about six weeks ago, they've just drawn game after game after game. They've still got a big gap.
Yeah.
But can they afford too many 0-0 draws like that?
Well, again, it's away from home. I always say away from home, a point is a good point. But you're right, since we were saying, look, they're the champions now, and they have remained top of the division, amazingly, because no one else seems to have put a winning run together. They have lost a couple, and they've drawn a few as well, but they just need to keep putting the points on the board, whether it's via draws or victories. Darren Ferguson, I'm sure, will have set a target, and he'll be saying, you know, four or five more wins, and we've guaranteed our place in the top three. And that's all they'll be bothered about. Look, it's nice if you win the title, but like I said last week, promotion is the be-all and end-all for clubs like Doncaster.
I don't
want
to get into this again, don't
you? I know. Well, it is nice to win the title, but all the, at the start of the season, they would have earmarked getting promoted. And trying to do that automatic, not through the playoffs. We can do it in the top three, and then we can plan for next season. And it would be a massive shock and a massive turnaround if they were to miss out now, despite them drawing a few in the last few weeks.
Yeah, no doubt about that. And let's face it, I don't want to go too much into the whole, no one's bothered about winning the league. But maybe they were listening to you last week, John, and thought, actually, yeah, we're not bothered about winning the league, we're just going to go up. We're not bothered about the trophy.
Look, I'm sure that if you can win the league, it's nice, but they're more, the people who run the club and Darren Ferguson, the target first is to secure promotion.
I know. I get that.
Once you're promoted, then you can think,
just nice to have it in the trophy cabinet. It's nice to win it.
I'm not saying it isn't, but the target is promotion. Once they've got promotion sorted, and it's the same for Sheffield United at the minute, get promotion over and done with, and then you can start looking at winning the league.
We'll wait and see anyway. We'll wait and see on that one. And anything new to say on York, lads?
I don't know whether they played this week or not, actually. I mean, there was quite a few postponements throughout the National League, as it's called now. I keep wanting to call it the Conference, but it is
still in danger of slipping into non-league north, aren't we?
Non-league north. Non-league north.
There's definitely a few postponements in non-league north.
Unbelievable. We'll get former York City correspondent Sam Bridges back on next week to clarify York's situation near the bottom of the National League. Lads, as always, absolute pleasure. And remember, for all your latest sports news, make sure you go to radioyorkshire.co.uk. Remember, you like and subscribe today. Get in touch with the comments as well. We'll pick up on them next week. Our man Joe Ross got quite a bit of flack from some of the Huddersfield Town fans, but unfortunately, I can't air them because it will be against broadcasting rules. So until next time, we'll see you soon.